स्टूडेंट्स, वेलकम बैक। माई सेल्फ पुष्पेंद्र सिंह एंड वी आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट विद द डेली करंट अफेयर्स। टुडे यू विल हैव द 2nd January 2021। ऑलराइट, सो यू विल हैव द 2nd January 2021 एंड वी आर गोइंग टू कवर द न्यूज फॉर द 2nd January एंड आई हैव टेकन द न्यूज फ्रॉम द टू न्यूज पेपर्स। द फर्स्ट इज द हिंदू न्यूज पेपर, ऑलराइट, and the second is Indian Express. Okay, so you can use any of these newspapers for your daily current affairs, all right, and you can also refer both of them because both of them are equally good. So you can use both of do not exceed the time for reading these two newspaper, right, by more than say 1.5 hours only. So you can give maximum 1.5 hours for reading these two newspapers. All right, so let's begin with the today's news, that is for 2nd January 2021. All right, so let's begin with the news. Okay, so the first news which is coming regarding basically the action agenda for an Atmanirbhar Bharat. All right, so you would have heard about the Atmanirbhar Bharat, which was initiated by the PM Narendra Modi. So today you will have the news regarding that Atmanirbhar Bharat. All right, so an action agenda for the Atmanirbhar Bharat was basically released, right? So it's a report. So what does that mean by action agenda? The action agenda means the course of the action that will be taken for making the India as a Atmanirbhar Bharat. So certain steps, right, would be taken in order to make the country independent and also make a Atmanirbhar Bharat. All right, so this action agenda, which was released by the Ministry of the Science and Technology, right? And this agenda was released by Dr. Harshvardhan, who was also the Minister of Science and Technology and the Minister of Health and Family Welfare. All right, and this action agenda is basically for making the India as a Atmanirbhar Bharat. And this is prepared by the Technology Information Forecasting and Assessment Council. So this is a council, which is an autonomous council under Ministry of Science and Technology. So this, the Technology Information Forecasting and Assessment Council has prepared the report for an action agenda for making India an Atmanirbhar Bharat. All right. And this report is basically released in New Delhi. All right. So let's understand the objective or the aim of this report. So the aim of this report is to create a sense of scientific social responsibility. All right. So that means you have to make an India Atmanirbhar, right? So that you need to create a sense of scientific social responsibility, right? And you have to lay down certain imperatives for future of the technology in India, because without integration of the technology, you cannot make the India Atmanirbhar, right? So for that, you need to have certain the scientific social responsibility also, and also it looks at certain challenges and the possibilities to find out the solutions for the various, you know, the challenges which the India faces currently. All right, so to find out those solutions which are practical and which are much needed for resolving those conflicts, right? So its main aim is to create the sense of scientific social responsibility and to lay down certain future of the technology in India. All right. And when we are talking about this, you know, this comprehensive action plan, which was released by the Ministry of Science and Technology, right, has been structured with the reference to the timeline, because it is not something that the intervention that you need for the Atmanirbhar Bharat, right, you need to stick with certain timeline that you need to implement, or you need to put those measures which are required, right, in this process. And also you need to highlight certain short and medium term and the long-term intervention plans, right, in certain identified sectors. So first of all, you need to identify certain sectors. Then you need to identify those plans which need to be implemented in those sectors. For example, short-term plans, the medium-term plans, long-term plans. And you need to stick, or you need to reference to those timelines, right, for intervention in those sectors. And this document, which is basically the comprehensive action plan, specifically defines the policies recommendations, the policy recommendations in the identifying domains, right? The domain of innovation and the technology development. Okay, because because that technology infusion and innovation is very much essential for any country to be developed, right? Including India. So you need the better advancement in terms of the innovation, in terms of technological development, the technological adoption and the diffusion of technology once you adopt the technology, right, to various, to the various levels, as well as you need to boost up the manufacturing and the productivity also, right? So you need to boost up that manufacturing capacity of the India. You need to boost up the productivity, because there are two terms called production and the productivity. All right. So you need to increase the productivity in order to become a Atmanirbhar Bharat, right? Or apart from that, you need to also increase your production also. And then trade and the globalization, you need to increase the share, right, in terms of the trade, the international trade, right, in terms of the ranking, in terms of the globalization, right, and also the internet policy and the data management, because now the most crucial, right, the oil, what we talk in the current scenario is data. So data is a new oil. The data is the new oil. The many multinational companies are basically using that data to garner certain most important information regarding the likeliness, regarding the choices of the customers, right? So if those data can be utilized for better corporate planning, for better, import and export of those, those items. For example, if there are many MNCs which have the data regarding the choices of the customers from India, right? If they push that item, right, for the customers in India, obviously they will have the greater benefit in pushing of those items in the Indian context. For example, the McDonald's, right? The McDonald's had started, adopting certain indigenizing of certain, recipes, right? For example, you have, right, you don't find in India, for example, the beef made products in the McDonald's, but that is very famous in the USA. So the McDonald's has basically adopted the indigenization of the feeding habits. So this is one such preferences which the McDonald's have adopted. All right. And also you need the education and the training and artificial intelligence, which is the most important aspect of this document, right? All right. So this was the first news. Let's understand the second news in that regard. So data on the police organizations. All right. So first of all, there is the Bureau of Police Research and the Development, which is an independent bureau, which basically collect those data related to the police and police organizations, and which also publishes that data. So this Bureau of Police Research and Development, right, released the data on the police organizations in our country as of January 1, 2020. So let's understand the key findings of the data which was recently released by the Bureau of Police Research and the Development. All right. So let's understand those data. So first of all, the first finding is that the number of people getting the police protection. The police protection means you have the protection cover, right, which have been provided to those people across India stood in 2019 is 19,467, right? So it was 19,467 people got the police protection across the country. And if you compare this figure in 2018, it was 21,300. That means there is a clear reduction of 1,833 people, or roughly 8.7% of those people have been reduced from getting the protection. So roughly you can say that around 19,000 people are getting the police protection across the India. And the number of police personnel put on the protection duty in 2018 and 2019, right, are mainly, employed for the minister's protection, for MP's protection, for MLA's protection, for judges' protection, for the bureaucrats' protection. And, right, for the protection of these main, personnels, there is outnumbered sanctioned strength for the job by around 35%. That means, for the protection of these people, like ministers, MPs, MLAs, judges, and the bureaucrat, there is, the more number of people have been there for the duty. For example, if there is sanction strength of 100, 135 people have been positioned for their protection. So that is outnumber in their strength, right, for this job by around 35%. All right. So this is also the most important data. All right. And when you compare the data from the state wise, the West Bengal has the maximum number of people under the police protection. Okay, so West Bengal has 3,142 people under police protection in 2019, so which is the highest among the states, right? Which is followed by the Punjab, which has 2,594 people, and which is followed by the Bihar, which is 2,347 people, and which is followed by the Jammu and Kashmir, which is 1,184. All right, and when you talk about the maximum sanction strength and the deployment of those police personnel, right, in Delhi, right? So that is the maximum strength have been deployed in Delhi, right? And the number of protectees when you talk in Delhi is around 503 in 2018, and in 2019 it is 501. So 501 there is protectees in Delhi, right, according to this data. And the number of police personnel sanctioned for the protection of the duties in Delhi was 7,144 in 2018, which has increased to 7,294 in 2019, right? And the deployment number stood, right, which is around 7,144 and 8,182 in 2019 respectively, right? So this is basically the data regarding the police personnel which were deployed, right, for the protection of the MPs, MLAs, right, the bureaucrats, right, right, and for other, you know, the political figures. All right, let's understand the consortia, which is related to the SARS-CoV virus. So it is the Indian SARS-CoV-2 genome consortia, which is also known as INSACOG. So it is basically the Indian SARS-CoV-2 genome consortia. All right, so the government of India has launched this genome consortia, right, which is also known as the Indian SARS-CoV-2 genome consortia, which is also known as INSACOG, which was launched recently by the government of India. Now, what is this consortia is all about? First of all, you must understand why it is needed, this consortia. All right, so first of all, you must understand who are the members of this consortia. So the mainly members of these consortias are basically the labs or the diagnosis labs, or those research institutions which have certain diagnostic, you know, capability of diagnosing this, you know, different type of the genomic variations of the SARS-CoV-19 virus. All right, so you might have heard about that genetic variations of the SARS-CoV-2 virus also been reported in the UK. All right, so this genome which was reported in the UK is also a cause of the concern, right, to effectively deal with such, you know, genetic variations in the SARS-CoV-2 genome, a consortia was launched. And this consortia would have the basically the most important, you know, the scientific community from the important labs. So it will have the scientific community from these labs. So overall aim of the consortia is to monitor the genomic variations. For example, if the new gene have been developed or have been evolved in the SARS-CoV-2 virus, right? So you must understand, right, you need to monitor, right? For that, you need to have a regulatory work, or you need to have the regular basis through multi-laboratory network. Then only you can monitor the genomic variations in the SARS-CoV-2 virus. And this consortia would have the research capability to assist, you know, to develop certain potential vaccines in the future also, because they will collecting the data and they will be finding these genomic variations. And with the help of this data and genomic variations, there is a high possibility of use that data for collecting the vaccines, right, or for making the vaccines in the future, right, for those genomic variations, right? So this genomic consortia would consist of 10 labs, right? These labs are nothing but the DVT NIBMG Kalyani, the DVT Bhubaneswar, ICMR NIB Pune, the DVT NCCS Pune, CSIR CMBB, CCMMB Hyderabad, DVT CDFD Hyderabad, DVT Bangalore, NIMHNS Bangalore, CSIR IGIB Delhi, and NCDC Delhi. So these are the 10 labs which are integrated or which are involved in this consortia. All right. And this consortia, which is named as INSA COG will have the high level interministerial steering committee also. All right. So interministerial steering committee will have the multiple stakeholders from the different ministries. All right. So it will have the multi-stakeholder steering committee from the different ministries, and this interministerial steering committee would definitely provide the guidance and the oversight to this consortium, because this consortium would work ultimately under the guidance of the interministerial committee. So this interministerial steering committee, which would provide a guidance and the oversight to this consortia, especially for the policy matters, and it will have the scientific advisory group for the scientific and the technical guidance, right? So this scientific advisory group would give certain scientific and the technical guidance to those consortia, right? To this consortia. Now, this consortia is coordinated by the Department of Biotechnology, along with the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, Indian Council of Medical Research, and Council of Scientific and Industrial Research, CSIR, right? And also the strategy and roadmap of the National SARS-CoV-2 Genome Sequencing Consortium has been prepared, right? So this strategy was basically coordinated by the Department of Biotechnology, all right? So this is the news which is flashing regarding the consortium, all right? Let's understand the new news, which is regarding the Gavi. Gavi means the Global Alliance for Vaccine and Immunization, right? So you must understand it is a global alliance for the vaccines and the immunization. So what is the news which is flashing is that the Minister of Health or Union Minister of Health and Family Welfare, who is also the Dr. Harshvardhan, have been nominated by the Gavi, which is a global alliance for the vaccine and immunization, as a member on the Gavi board, right? So he will be the member on the Gavi board, right? And the Dr. Harshvardhan would be representing the Southeast Asia Regional Office, which is also known as SEARO, and Western Pacific Regional Office constituency, right, on the Gavi board. So he will be representing the SEARO and Western Pacific Regional Office constituency on the Gavi board, and Harshvardhan will be representing India from the 1st January 2021 until 31st of December 2023. So he will have the tenure of around, say, for 3 years, right? 2021, 22, and 2023. So he will have the tenure of around 3 years in this Gavi board, right? And the board normally meets twice a year, in the month of June, and in the month of either November or in the month of December. And the Gavi board also hold an annual retreat, and normally in the month of March or the April. All right. And the Gavi board, which you are talking about, this Gavi board is responsible for the strategic direction and the policy making, right? It will be responsible for the strategic direction and the policy making. And it will also oversee the operations of the vaccine alliance and monitors the program implementation, right? So whatever the vaccine alliances which have been formed, right? So it will oversee those operations. And also, if there is an implementation program regarding the vaccination, it will also monitor the program for implementation for those vaccination program also. All right. So this is the news. Let's understand the new news, which is also known as Tehan IIT Hyderabad. All right. So there is an IIT which is called IIT Hyderabad. Okay. This is the new IIT which was set up, right? So the news which is regarding is that the Union Minister of Education recently has laid a foundation stone of Tehan IIT Hyderabad, right? Where this Tehan IIT Hyderabad is the first, India's first test bed for autonomous navigation system, which is also known as terrestrial and aerial, right? What is this autonomous navigation systems? For example, you have unmanned aerial vehicles, right? So the India's first test bed for these autonomous navigation systems, which are also an example of the unmanned aerial vehicles, where there won't be any pilot, but they are remotely controlled, or they are autonomous navigation system. For that, at IIT Hyderabad campus, the first, India's first test bed have been laid a foundation by the Union Minister of Education recently, right? And you must understand, the Department of Science and Technology, Government of India, has sanctioned 135 crore rupees to the IIT Hyderabad under the national mission of on interdisciplinary cyber physical system. So under this national mission on interdisciplinary cyber physical systems, 135 crore rupees have been sanctioned by the Department of the Science and Technology to IIT Hyderabad, right, to set up a technology innovation hub on autonomous navigation and the data acquisition system, which is nothing but the unmanned aerial vehicles which have been autonomously navigated, or where you don't have to put the pilots on board, right? So for such, India's first test bed would be set up at IIT Hyderabad. All right. And the technology innovation hub on autonomous navigation system for this UAV and remotely operated vehicles, which are also known as ROV. And what is this? Unmanned aerial vehicles. They are also called UAV, right? So this technology innovation hub on this autonomous navigation systems, which will be ultimately set up at IIT Madras, which will be known as Tihan Foundation, which will be known as the Tihan Foundation. And the Tihan Foundation is incorporated as Section 8 under the Company Act, by the Institute, right, in the June 2020. So this Tihan Foundation is a multi-departmental initiative. What is that multi-departmental initiatives? Which means there will be involvement of the researchers from the interdepartmental streams. For example, there will be involvement of the researchers from the electrical engineering department. There will be involvement of the researchers from the computer science engineering department. There will be involvement of the researchers from the mechanical engineering department, from aerospace engineering department, from civil engineering department, from mathematics department, and from the design department at IIT Madras. And it would also have the collaboration and the support from the reputed institutions and the industry. And that will ultimately provide those, you know, the support and the collaboration to those, the Tihan Foundation. All right. And regarding the features of this Tihan Foundation, it will have the facility include the test tracks, because you need the unmanned aerial vehicles to land and go. So you need the test tracks. You need the emulsion of the real world scenarios, right? You need to create that scenario. You need the state of art simulation technologies, right? You need the road infrastructure which can connect it. You need the V2X communication systems. You need the drone runways. You need the landing areas, isn't it? You need the mechanical integration facility. You need a centralized control room or the ground control room to manage the unmanned aerial vehicles or the remotely operated vehicles at IIT Hyderabad. You need the hangars where you can keep those unmanned aerial vehicles, and many more associated infrastructure is also needed for the Tihan Foundation, which have been recently incorporated under Section 8 by the Institute of IIT Hyderabad, right? So the recently the foundation have been led by the Ministry of Science, the Ministry of the Education, all right, or Union Minister of Education, all right. So this is basically, you know, a Tihan Foundation. So first of all, this new hub have been established in the 2 acres of this land inside the campus of IIT Hyderabad. And this facilities will be planned in a phased manner. This facility will be planned in a phased manner. And this would definitely facilitate the research grounds to investigate the functioning of unmanned and connected vehicles in the controlled environment, right? So it will definitely facilitate the research grounds, and it will help to replicate the different scenarios, right? And ranging from the frequency occurring to the extreme cases may be ensued in the real life traffic operations within the campus. And you will have the smart poles within the institute, right, which are enabled with the communication technology, right? And those poles will be designed to have certain type of sprinklers to stimulate the rain scenario or real type of rain scenario, right? So that will basically replicate the real life scenarios within the campus of IIT Hyderabad. So this is called the Rihan. This is called basically the Tihan Foundation, which will be set up. All right. Let's understand the new news, which is MET Center at Leh. So that is Meteorological Center at Leh, right? So what is that Meteorological Center? So that will basically provide certain, you know, this Meteorological Center will provide certain information, right? Information regarding the weather and the climate. It will provide the information regarding the weather and the climate, right? So let's understand, the Union Minister of Earth and Sciences inaugurated this meteorological center at the Leh in the Ladakh region, all right? So this meteorological center, which was inaugurated by the Union Minister of Earth Sciences, this meteorological center is located at the height of 3,500 meters. And this would be the highest meteorological center in India, right? This would be the highest meteorological center in India. And this center would be the world-class facility for this high-altitude meteorology, because you must understand, to set up a meteorological center at that altitude of 3,500 meters is challenging. And that will provide, or that will cater the various needs of the weather-related and the climate-related needs of the people, and especially the administration of Ladakh, because it's a basically, you know, also the cold and arid region, all right? And it will definitely provide the forecast for the important tourist places like Nubra, right, Changtang, the Pangong Lake, the Zanskar, the Kargil, the Dras, Dhabema, which is in Aryan Valley, and Kalsi, among the others. So it will provide, right, those forecasting regarding the weather and the climatic conditions, not only to the administration of the Ladakh, but also the people, right, or also for the tourists also in the different tourist places also. All right, let's understand the new news, which is also known as ginger processing plant at Ribhoi. So first of all, its name itself suggests it's a ginger processing plant. So ginger, you know, adrak, right? It's a ginger processing plant. And what is this Ribhoi? This Ribhoi is nothing but it is a district in Meghalaya. All right. So the ginger processing plant, the Northeast first ever specialized ginger processing plant at the Ribhoi, which is also a district in the Meghalaya, have been recently revived. So it is a first such specialized ginger processing plant in the northeastern India. And this would be likely to be functional in the beginning of 2021. And this ginger processing plant of the Northeast India was established in 2004, but it remained non-functional for many years. And later it was revived, and it is in the process of reviving, and it will be functional in the year of 2021, right? And you must understand that a separate corporation, which is also known as the Northeastern Regional Agricultural and Marketing Corporation, which is also known as NERAMAC, which is nothing but a PSU, which is nothing but in PSU, have been undertaken to take the responsibility of reviving this ginger processing, you know, center, right, or ginger processing plant in a initial steps to operationalize the closed plant through PPP mode. What is the PPP mode? PPP means public private partnership, right? So under public private partnership, there is a plan by this Northeastern Regional Agricultural Marketing Corporation, which is an PSU, right, to revive this, the ginger processing, you know, plant, right, and to operationalize such closed plant through the public-private partnership mode. And let's understand about this NERAMAC. So NERAMAC, which is also known as Northeastern Regional Agricultural Marketing Corporation, which is an PSU, working under the aegis of the Ministry of Development of Northeastern Region, which is also known as DONOR. So it is an PSU which is working under Ministry of DONOR. All right. So let's understand the new news, which is related to the lightning strike. Lightning, you know, the bijli girna. So it is related to that. So it is during the rainfall time or during the cyclones, the basically lightning strikes occur throughout the world. Okay. So it is a report regarding the casualties or the deaths that occur because of this lightning phenomena. Okay, so first you must understand, the lightning strikes have caused 1,771 deaths between the April 1, 2019 and March 31, 2020. So this lightning strike have caused 1,771 deaths, okay, in the last 1 year. And this report was basically published on December 31st, 2020, right, on various lighting incidents in India. So it has caused 1,771 deaths in India, right? If you compare this data, right, in the last 1 year, in 2008, deaths were 2,800, you know, reported. So it is a clear drop of the deaths, right, that was caused because of this lightning, that is caused because of lightning. And this has, you know, why this lesser number of deaths have caused, because of the various effort, you know, has put by the various stakeholders, including the National Disaster Management Authority, by the state government, by the central government, and by other, you know, the paramilitary forces, which basically, you know, help the people to make their capacities in order to, you know, in order to safeguard from themselves from the lightning. All right. And regarding the state-wise data, the Uttar Pradesh has the maximum deaths. So 293 deaths occurred in the Uttar Pradesh, okay, which is followed by Madhya Pradesh, where 241 deaths occur, which is followed by the Bihar, where 221 deaths occur, which is followed by the Odisha, where 200 deaths occur, which is followed by the Jharkhand, where 172 deaths occur, right? And if you combine the Uttar Pradesh, Madhya Pradesh, Bihar, Odisha, and the Jharkhand, these deaths together account for more than 60% of the deaths, of the 60% of the total deaths, if you compare these states. And 33% of the total fatalities, right, from all natural disaster, because the lightning is a natural disaster, right? So if you compile the data, 33% of all deaths or all fatalities would be caused by this natural disaster or by this lightning natural disaster during the same time period. All right. So 33% of the deaths occur because of this lightning. And the maximum number of lightning strike occur in the Orissa, where 11.20 lakh plus lightning strike was reported, and which is the highest in the country. And only 200 casualties occur in the state of Odisha, right? And even during Cyclone Fani, the state saw more than 1 lakh intense lightning strikes, all right? In the year of 2019, precisely May 3 to May 4 in 2019, and which has also devastated, you know, the state of Odisha during Cyclone Fani. All right, let's understand the International Organization of Securities Commissions, right? So which is also known as OSCO, which is nothing but the International Organization of Securities Commissions. So the International Financial Services Center Authority now has become the associate member of OSCO, right? So this is the news which is flashing in the Hindu newspaper, that the IFSCA, which is also known as the International Finance Service Center Authority, now this has become an associate member of OSCO, right? So what is that OSCO? First of all, you must understand, the OSCO, which is also known as the International Organization of the Securities Commission, is an international organization, right, that bring together the world security regulators, okay? So you have the security markets. You have the security markets, including India, right? So you have the world securities market, right? So that ISCO, or International Organization of Security Market, or ISCO, would basically, you know, have the membership of this world security regulators. And this ISCO would cover around 95% of the world security market, right? Isn't it? And this organization is also, or this commission is also, you know, a global standard setter for this security sector or security markets sector, and which will be followed by almost all, market securities regulators. All right. And this ISCO work closely with the G20 countries, and is also work closely with the Financial Stability Board. All right. And in setting up of different type of, you know, the standards for the strengthening of the security markets in the world. All right. And the principal objectives and the principles of the ISCO is basically the securities regulations, right, which is also endorsed by the Financial Stability Board, which is also known as FSB. So it is known as the Financial Stability Board, right? And it is one of the key standards for the sound financing systems in the world. And this was founded, or ISCO was founded in 1983, and is headquartered at the Madrid, which is in Spain. All right, so this is the news. Let's understand the second news, which is known as the Paradip port, right? So it is a port which is known as Paradip, right? So this port is basically the Union Cabinet has approved the project deepening and optimization of inner harbor facilities, right? So you must understand there is a necessity of deepening of those harbors because you need certain amount of depth for the ship to come in, right? And to ship to go out. And you need to optimize these harbor facilities, right? Right? So that these harbor facilities can be used for various docking and undocking process, right? So the Union Cabinet has approved the project for the deepening and optimization of inner harbor facilities, right? Including the development of the Western Dock on built, operate and transfer basis. All right. So there is a development of this harbor facilities, especially on the Western Dock on BOT basis under public-private partnership, right? More to handle the capsize vessels at the Paradip port. All right. So this would be, you know, a project which would be developed on the BOT basis. All right. So this proposed project, which will be used, right, for optimizing of inner harbor facilities and for deepening of this harbor, is emphasize the construction of the Western Dock Basin of the Paradip port. And that will handle or that will facilitate the handle of capsized vessels by the selective or by the selected BOT concessionary. What is the BOT concessionary? Means the concessionary which will be involved in the deepening and the project facilitation or the project construction purpose. And that will ultimately, you know, enhance the capacity of the Western Dock Basin to 25 million tons per annum in the two phases of 12.5 million tons per annum each. So it will definitely enhance the optimization of the Western Dock Basin of the Paradip port by the selected BOT concessionary, which will definitely or ultimately involve the capacity addition of 25 million tons per annum, which will be built in the two phases. Then the first phase, 12.50 million tons per annum would be built, and the second phase, again the second 12.50 million tons per annum will be built. And let's understand the financial implications. So financial implications is the estimated cost of the project would be 3,000 crore rupees, or roughly 3,004 crore rupees. And it will include the development of the new Western Dock, right? So it will be including the development of new Western Dock on the BOT basis. BOT means built, operate, transfer. That means there will be concessionary which will build this facility, which will operate this facility for, let's say, for 30 years and 40 years. And by that time, it will try to, you know, try to regain its, you know, the investment which has been making or which have it made, and it will transfer the facility to the government of India. All right. So that is called build, operate and transfer. So that means for the significant period of the time, it will operate the facilities after building this facility. Okay. So it will bring the fresh amount of money, right? It will build the facility. It will operate the facility, let's say, for 30 years. It will be written down during the awarding of this project. And after completing this operating facility, right, this facility will be transferred to the government of India. All right. And there will be, you know, dredging by the selected concessionary also at the cost of 2040 crore rupees and 352 crore rupees respectively, right? So it will have the financial implications of around 3000 crore rupees for optimizing of this Paradip port. All right, so this is the view of Paradip port. All right, so that's all for the news for today, and we will cover the next news in our next class. All right, so thank you very much for attending this session. Thank you.